Good morning and welcome to Seeds for Story with Pamela Sherrod Anderson. My name is Heather Nice and I am the Director of Education at the Abraham Lincoln Presidential Library and Museum. Pamela is here to speak to you as part of the No Malice Film Contest, a contest created in partnership with the Roger and Chaz Ebert Foundation and the Abraham Lincoln Presidential Library Foundation to address topics of racial healing. To learn more about the contest, please visit bit.ly/No Malice Film Contest. Before we start the presentation with Pamela, I'd like to thank Chaz Ebert for making these sessions possible and play a short video she asked me to share with you.
And welcome everybody to the fourth of our five workshops on filmmaking for the No Malice Film Contest. Today we are so pleased to have my friend Pamela Sherrod Anderson. This talented director was once a journalist and editor, and she knows all about storytelling. Heather will give you her background, but that's why we invited her to talk to you about Seeds for Story. So sit back, you're in for a treat. Bye-bye.
Thank you for that great intro, Chaz. Now, without further ado, I'd like to introduce Pamela Sherrod Anderson, founder of Graceworks Theater and Film Productions, LLC. Pamela is an award-winning writer, filmmaker, playwright, educator, and journalist. She is currently board chair of Cartemquin Films, which celebrates its 55th anniversary in 2021 and remains even more committed to social justice and democracy through documentary. Her films have been shown in national and international film festivals and are available on streaming services. She has taught in film and journalism departments at DePaul University and Columbia College of Chicago. Her illustrious journalism career includes editor, reporter, and columnist at Chicago Tribune Newspaper and United Press International. Pamela is a proud product of Chicago's South Side and proud of her family's Alabama, Louisiana, and Mississippi roots. As Pamela shares her presentation, please be sure to enter your questions into the Q&A box so we can get to them after she finishes her presentation. If you have any issues hearing or seeing, please use the chat box to let me know. Pamela, it's all yours. Pamela, don't forget to unmute.
Thank you so much, Heather, and thank you so much, Chaz, for the introduction. I'm really happy to be with you this morning, and I'm so excited and really jazzed to share with you what I know about storytelling. My background is one of a journalist. I started as a journalist and working for major news organizations, magazines, and newspapers, and that's where my training started. But I have to admit, the bug for storytelling started much earlier than that. As a child, I was one who listened to the stories of those who were in my neighborhood and certainly in my home. I loved hearing the stories of others and also wanting to share and tell other people about what I had heard. Many of the stories that I came to know about in my neighborhood, I saw through a window, through my bedroom window. And in some ways, it was that frame, kind of like the movie frame that we have today. It has carried me through in terms of the storytelling that I do and the way that I see a good way to frame stories and to bring them to life. Racial healing, with that being the theme of this particular film contest, is particularly important to me because I feel like the movie that helped to tell that story the most, Curators of Dixon School, is a study and how it's possible to do that on an everyday and on an ongoing basis. I happened upon Dixon Elementary School, which is on Chicago's South Side, several years ago. I learned about the school through a person who had just written a book about a wonderful art collection there. Knowing my background as a journalist and storyteller, he thought I would be interested in writing about it and taking the theme of art and design. You will find, as young filmmakers, that when people learn that you have a camera and that you are interested in film, story ideas will come to you. And you will think, oh, this is maybe something I can go with. And that served to be true for me in my career as well. People would come to me with story ideas, and some of them would pan out to be very good, and some would be fair. As I learned about the art collection at Dixon Elementary School, I thought it sounded like a good idea, but I was not expecting to see the art collection that I saw. I was expecting to see maybe 6 to 10 beautiful works of art, perhaps in the principal's office, or maybe just outside the principal's office. Instead, when I visited the school, I found more than 300 works of art throughout the whole school. That in itself was a story. But what I wanted to find out is, how does this story really come to life? That was my seed for the story to come to life for the screen. It's one thing to show the art collection, to walk through the school with a camera and point the camera at the art and say, here, look at the art collection. It's another thing to bring that art collection to life. And that's what I did with the curators of Dixon School. It's also something that can be done in terms of bringing your stories to life when it comes to racial healing. The art collection at the school served to be much more than the pretty pictures on the wall. And there were many. There were original works of art by some very well-known African-American artists. There are antiquities that were throughout the school, and everything was there for the children to enjoy. So I'm going to have some help in bringing up the opening of curators of Dixon School so you can see exactly what I saw on my first visit. In the opening, you will meet the principal, and the principal is giving some tough love as she's talking to the graduating seniors, but you'll also see how that love translates throughout the story.
Good morning. First of all, let me congratulate each and every one of you, Arthur Dixon Elementary School. We come out on days such as today, 8th grade graduation, and it's a grand celebration. It's a grand celebration through our families, through our communities. But the reality is that some of us did the bare minimum. We did just enough to get by. What are you going to do to get from today to the rest of your life? Now, I know that you are children, but you are faced with some decisions now as children that many of us as adults have never had to face. And so I'm asking you to be conscious of the decisions that you make, because they will be long-lasting. Bryce Bailey, stand up. Jeffrey Knight, stand up. Russell Robinson, stand up. Ladies, I'm not overlooking you, but most of the time, spread across this stage, all we have is ladies. It is a privilege and a pleasure to see 3 African-American males in the top 10 valedictorian, salutatorian. You guys ought to be congratulated. Keep up the great work. Change is inevitable, but growth is optional.
When I grow up, and I am free. I want to be a righteous healer. I'll stand for truth and teach the youth. Care for the baby and the elder. And from the earth will come the birth of all my herbs and healing potions. And every day my soul will pray that love will be my whole devotion. And I'll walk it every day, my Lord, I pray.
Like the wind, strong like a tree, high like a cloud, deep like the sea. When I grow up, that's how I'll be.
I hope you enjoyed seeing that clip. That's the opening for Curators of Dixon School. And what you will notice is that the film has the name also Hallways of Hope, because when I visited the school, that's what you feel. You feel the hope that's there in the community. You'll also find that as you're working on your film, the title will become important to you. You'll go back and forth with it. Hallways of Hope was one title that the film was used when it was picked up for distribution. But it came back to its original title of the Curators of Dixon School, because the title Curators means the teachers as well as the students were very much part of curating what happened at the school and in the art collection. So the title we stayed with was the Curators of Dixon School. Throughout the art collection, you see all the beautiful artwork, and it's amazing to see it displayed there in the school. But the seed for this story, for it to become a documentary, occurred to me because it was not only the beautiful pictures on the wall, but also the teachers that I met and the students. Through them, I wanted to bring the story to life. They served really as the seeds for story. And the best way to bring a story to life is through the people, the most important people. There was something that also inspired me in walking through the school. In walking through the school first, before I even started with the camera, I wanted to get to know the students and I wanted to get to know the teachers. That means a relationship. You build a relationship with the people so that they get to know you and you get to know them. You may not use everyone that you get to know during that time in the film, but it provides background for the story that you're going to do. So all the information that you gather is information that's going to be of use to you in making the film. So never think anything is going to go to waste. But the most important thing I have found in my storytelling is building the relationship, and why it's important to build a relationship with the people who are going to be in the film is so that they can trust you and they can feel that they can also trust you in telling the story, their story. The old school way of thinking about learning was about the three R's: reading, writing, and arithmetic. With the Curators of Dixon School, what I found, they had a fourth very important R, an R that I think is also important in racial healing, and that R is respect. Respect was something that was taught throughout the school, throughout the art collection, in the teachers and in the students. But as I saw that, how do I bring that to life? It's one thing to talk about it, but it's another thing to show it. There was one piece of artwork that helped me to really bring that story to life, and it was something that I meditated on in a way as I was working on the film, and that was the Tree of Life. The Tree of Life is a sculpture that you see in the hallway of the school. The Tree of Life is something that served to motivate and inspire me throughout the making of the film. I'm going to show you a brief clip now of the Tree of Life so that you can see up close what it really means to have a helper, to have a hand there to bring you on, and what that shows within the school community, from the teachers, the students, and how it's shown in the art collection as well. The Tree of Life.
This is a what they call a tree of life. And it's actually carved out of ebony. And it's one piece of wood. And the tree of life to us, if you look at it, you see how from the bottom all the way up to the top, people lifting up, resting on other people's shoulders, the strength of the foundation that has raised them all the way to the top. But it also represents the spirit of our school, which is that no one individual is responsible for our school's success. And as you can tell, when you look at that piece, you really can't distinguish one from the other. You don't know who is royalty in that piece. You don't know who are the workers. All you see is a team of people pulling together. And that's what that represents for us here, a team, a village pulling together to reach the highest heights possible.
So the Tree of Life sculpture is actually at the very opening of the film, as well as something that you see when you come into the school for the first time. But as I say, it's one thing to talk about something, it's another to really see it. And with the Tree of Life sculpture, I use that as a way to inspire me to find the stories within the school to help bring the art collection to life, so that you could see the three R's come to life, and particularly that fourth very important R of respect. And how is that shown? So I started with the teachers at the school, getting to know them. You've already met one teacher who is also the principal of the school, Joan Chrysler. She's also the person who started the art collection at Dixon Elementary School. And keep in mind, Dixon Elementary School is a school that is not a special art school. It's basically an old-fashioned public school in Chicago, located on the South Side in the Chatham neighborhood. In speaking with Joan, I could see that she had a love of art personally, and through her own personal love of art is how she brought it into the school environment, because she felt that if she loved art and if it made her feel good, it was something that was going to make her students as well as her teachers feel good as well. But it also helped to impart a lesson to the teachers as well as the students about community and what it takes to really be a family within a school and to be that safe place for the students to learn the lessons they need to learn, certainly from the books, but also learn the lessons in life with it shown in the artwork on the walls as well as seen in the sculptures in the hallway. So Joan Chrysler is one of the educators that we see. And I'm going to show just a very short clip of Joan next.
Joan Chrysler is passionate about education and art. She found a way to combine her love for both during her 20 years as principal of Dixon School. She recently left Dixon when she was chosen to mentor and train other educators to become public school principals.
What we appreciate as adults, we should share that with children. Because how do children learn if we don't teach them? And part of the school's collecting was, as a principal, you spend so much time here in your work environment. So you want your work environment to be just as nurturing and comforting and inspiring as your home environment or any other environment. So you begin to create that and bring your kids into that. And that's just how I've started. It started very unintentionally, actually. It just evolved. Much of the artwork, as you can see, is not behind glass. It's not secured. It's freestanding, just as it would be in any museum. And that's by design. If we send the message to children that we trust them, and we respect them to honor the art, they will do that. And
so we stopped there with Joan because she's the principal of the school and as well as the founder of the art collection. And oftentimes what happens is when you have a very strong leader and someone who has started something like an art collection or something very important to the school, they're the main driver of that engine. When I learned that she was going to retire, although Joan has never really retired, she's continued to mentor and to be there for other educators and students. But when she technically retired from her position as principal at Dixon Elementary School, I was concerned because the art collection was such a focal point there at the school. And while people talked about how the teachers and the students were all very much on board and seeing the importance of it, I wanted to stay on and continue to film there to see if that really was going to be the case. Was the next principal going to carry on that message? How was that going to really be displayed? How were we going to see that? So that meant staying on a little longer. That became another seed for the story, not only to see how Joan had built that collection, but also to see how her successor, how the person who was her assistant principal was going to carry on that message. And what I learned and what I started to really bring out in the film is that everybody really was on board with this message of seeing the importance of having positive images of African-American life and art shown throughout the school and it being part of the everyday lesson plan for the children. Not something seen as extracurricular, but something that was part of the everyday lesson plan. The new principal who came in had been her assistant principal, Sharon Dale. Sharon had not taught or been at a public school. She had been at private schools before. And the reason is because she had been concerned about the negative messages that have come out about public schools. And when I visited Dixon Elementary School, to be very truthful, the headlines and stories that came out about Chicago public schools were negative. You didn't see the positive stories. And I almost hesitate to use the word positive because people tend to think that in some way you're trying to pander. But there's something to be said for seeing all the dimensions of African-American life. And this school certainly exemplified that. They're not alone in that. They're an example of what some of the educators are doing and how they're bringing that message across in the best way that they can. Sharon Dale as assistant principal, when she came in to the role as principal, she carries on that same message, but getting to know her was part of helping this story grow as well. So when we meet Sharon Dale seeing that she's doing some of the same things that the previous principal had done in meeting students at the door and saying good morning to them, knowing them by name and greeting them with a smile, making sure that when they crossed that threshold into the school, they were crossing a threshold where they were going to be loved and nurtured. And the next clip is going to show our meeting Sharon Dale.
Sharon Dale, who was assistant principal to Mrs. Chrysler, now heads Dixon.
We need to be visible, not just during the morning, but throughout the day. It's a job that you're the mother at times, you're a father, you're a nurse.
Come in quietly, guys. Quietly, quietly, quietly. Alexis, get a smile on your face.
But it's a wonderful job because a lot of times you affect a lot of lives, not, you know, sometimes it's a family and not just a child or a student. You take care of the kids first.
Good morning.
And then everything else comes second.
Good morning.
When she was principal, she would always go down at that end, and I, as assistant, would be at this end. So now that on the festival. I just switched and went to her area. So.
I literally was afraid to come to the Chicago Public Schools because of all the things that you heard about the children in the schools. And none of that did I find here.
Sharon was one of our important people that helped to tell the story. And because you are going to be meeting people, and you may already have someone in mind now that you want to tell a story about. But one of the things we found in doing this story, and I was so fortunate to work with a wonderful team, a wonderful camera person, Inez Summer, who's also a co-producer on the project, as well as Sharon Zurich, who is a co-producer and editor on the project. It really helps to have an extra pair of eyes along the way. But what we found with Sharon, while she was a willing participant, sometimes we had to run after her with the camera because she was also shy. So we took that into consideration. But in telling her story, it was also very helpful in our telling the rest of the story as it related to the art collection. Sharon, along with Joan, were the educators at the school that helped to bring this story to life. The next educator who helped us to bring this story to life was Annette Malika Jackson. She's the art teacher at the school. Of course, when you hear that a school has an art collection, you immediately think, well, obviously, you must want all of your students to become artists. That would be great, but that's not the only motivation for the art collection. The art collection was there as a thing of beauty. Who doesn't want to see beauty every day? Who doesn't want to see their life, African-American life, shown in a beautiful way, where you're seeing families together, where you're seeing children going to school just as you're going to school, where they're sitting in a lunchroom just as you're sitting in a lunchroom, and they're reading their favorite book, or their favorite book is being read to them by their grandmother or their mother, another important adult in their life. So Annette Malika Jackson, the art teacher, brings to life not only learning how to become an artist, how to do art, but to appreciate nature and the beauties of life. So when we meet Annette Jackson, you'll get a chance to see what I saw in her as well. Annette Jackson is going to be our next clip.
It took me a very frustrating 2.5 years to find an art teacher. The teachers were patient, but after a while, they were like, where is the art teacher? Where's our prep period? Well, I am not looking for a person to provide you with a prep period. I'm looking for an art teacher to educate my children. I interviewed several people, but nobody really clicked with me. Annette saunters in. She opens up this portfolio, and everything in the portfolio was a piece of children's artwork. I hired her on the spot.
Use the opposite. And it'll keep you from getting tired and keep you going straight, too.
I was looking for a person who could use their talent, their creativity, their knowledge, their skills to help bring that gift out of the children. It's been a very, very productive 17 years.
So it's wonderful meeting these wonderful teachers because each one brought something different to the story. And it was a way of understanding not only the art that was on the walls, but also understanding the students that were in their charge and how they were helping them become beautiful works of art of their own. So it's not only the collection itself, but really seeing the students become those beautiful works of art in their own life. Annette was one of those key educators that I wanted to help tell that story. But the educators were not alone. In bringing the beautiful works of art to life in the students, it was important to having key students to help tell that story. So how to go about doing that? That takes me back to relationships. During the time that I was at the school filming, I got to know and to see the students, not only as they went from one classroom to another, but also in their individual classrooms. And I got a chance to see some personalities who stood out differently. They helped to tell stories that were seen in some of the works of art there on the wall. I met a student by the name of Gary. Gary was a student whose work, as well as his personality, came out. And like all good stories, we ended up having a cliffhanger with him. It ended up being a very important part of the story and bringing out something that I hadn't expected to come out. And that's something that happens with documentaries. That's probably my favorite thing, to be honest with you, is that you can't really judge exactly what's going to happen in the making of a film when it's a documentary. You don't have it planned and scripted out to the T. There are going to be different curves that come along the way, and that even as you're filming, you're going to find yourself being surprised. When we met Gary, he was a graduating eighth grader. Again, Dixon Elementary School is an elementary school. So the students that we chose were in the eighth grade because they were in their last year, and we wanted to see how they were going to transition out of that. When we met Gary, we met him in a school setting, classroom setting, and also a home setting. So the students, we saw them in the school, but we also wanted to get to know them in their home environment. We wanted to get to know them. It's all part of building a relationship. So the next clip is going to be of Gary, and we're going to see him in his home and get to know him personally. We'll see Gary next.
Civil rights. Parts of the Great Society target the nation's crumbling cities.
A lot of friends at school call me the reader. This is just a fraction of all the books I've read in my entire lifetime. I've even got some of my artwork up. That was a picture that I had sold at the school art fair. I'm very influenced by graffiti art. These are some notepads I got from art class and stuff. My strongest subject is reading. Ever since in the first grade, I was reading at an eighth grade level. And so I guess now I'm probably reading at a high school or college level. I don't know the statistics. My latest trophy and award that I was given for winning the Area 17 Science Fair, outstanding. I'm going to the City Science Fair, Cigarette Butt Literary Landing at Sea, which one will survive. I have a large quantity of pictures that I took during my project. I had a very extensive project. And last year I went to the City Science Fair too, and I'll go to City Science Fair again. This isn't the first time I've won Science Fair either. I've been winning Science Fairs at my school since first grade. Math has to be my weakest subject. For some reason, math just doesn't click. You know, anything else clicks, you know. I'm a computer genius, I'm a good reader. You know, like, if someone to come in here right now and break down my computer and rebuild it up, I could do it like after watching them do it or something, but it's just like math just doesn't click. It's just so difficult with me.
So at the time that we met Gary, we could see him excelling in almost all of his subjects. But we did not know that his challenges with math was going to be part of the story in a very important way. Again, that speaks to the surprises that come along when making a documentary. There are going to be different curves and turns that come along, and it's all part of the story. And it's something that keeps you, it's like the engine that helps to drive you forward in making your documentary, to really be true to the story that you're telling, and telling the story that's important for the main people in your film. Gary ended up being one of the main characters because he had won so many awards in science fair, he was doing so well in his classes, and his admission of being challenged with math. It was that vulnerability that spoke to us, and that we wanted to include in the documentary as we continued on. Our next important student, who really was a seed for the story, was Methuselah. I had never met anyone named Methuselah before. And when I met Methuselah, I found that he was a class president. He really shined in that way. And you could see that when he came onto the school playground and the respect that he had from other students. And it was really great to see how students respected and honored one another and seeing how they excelled and did well in their schoolwork. So in meeting Methuselah, we wanted to include him in the documentary about the curators of Dixon School and helping to bring the art collection to life, because he showed himself to be a class leader, and he also had his own individual story to tell that was important to the film. In this clip, we meet Methuselah, and you're going to meet him the way that I met him as well too.
Thank you.
All right, we'll see you later. Later.
So in a way, we see kind of a big man on campus, but Methuselah also has his own story to tell. He's actually here from West Africa, and he's visiting and staying with his family. With each one of the people that you've met so far, you can almost do a 3 to 5 minute or 3 to 4 minute documentary film on each of them. But what we found for this feature-length film, their individual stories help to bring the bigger story of the art collection to life, so that we know it's more than pretty pictures on the wall, and that we see it's really part of the everyday lesson plan for the students, and also an everyday lesson that's incorporated into the lives of the students, as well as the teachers and the adults that are important in their life. Our next important character who we felt we really needed to help tell the story was a young lady by the name of Octavia. Octavia was an honor roll student. And just like the Tree of Life talked about helping to reach for each other and to build each other up and to carry the next person on as you move on to the next higher ground, Octavia really is an example of that, along with some of the people that she had formed as a way to help counsel and to bring other students up to the honor roll level. Can you imagine that? This is something that was important to her and some of the other young mentors, that she was on the honor roll and she wanted to help others join her on that journey as well to get to that higher ground. So we're going to meet Octavia.
That's because you gifted.
I know. She like,
yeah. I'm gonna help you with your definitions.
Okay.
Are you lying to me?
You ask Ms. Bell right now?
We do it better than any teacher possibly could. I don't know about Ms. Bell or Ms. Mundy. Ms. Randall, she go all out. But what we do here is we show no weakness when it comes to our student.
They slow things down and I get a better understanding when they do it, because they more strict than the teachers. The teachers, like, they give you all the lesson in, like, just a one day.
You're like one of the students she can trust. So she know that she could trust us to do stuff that she needs to be done.
When you start off and you realize that you're failing and you might not go to the next grade, it's a big difference. It kind of does affect you, because it's like, this is my life, and this is the most important year for you. It determines if you go to high school or not. So I think it's important for him, and I think once we told him that, I think kind of made a change in like how he felt about it. Like, it made a change. Like, I know I need to work harder now because I need to go to high school. I need to go to the next grade level. This is important for me. So I think it does help.
So in watching the students tutor and mentor one another, it was really quite heartening because it spoke to the sculpture that I saw when I entered the school, the Tree of Life. It spoke to really people helping one another. And there was an example right there in the hallways of the school as I walked and visited the classrooms and visited the teachers and got to know the students and really started to see how the art collection was coming to life through the people, through the students, and how they were bringing it to life in this particular way with a mentor. Octavia was definitely a hard taskmaster, as well as the others who were helping to tutor and mentor their fellow students. But it was a way of seeing this lesson so that it was not a stagnant lesson about the art collection. I want you just to imagine, if in fact I had entered the school with the camera and just walked through from one floor after another, first floor, second floor, third floor, and just took footage and images of the art collection that was there. It's a beautiful art collection. Some very well-known and famous artists' works are throughout the school. I could have just focused on the individual pieces alone, but it was have been a story that would have just been flat. It wouldn't have been about people. In telling the story and really using the seeds of story for the main people and characters to bring Dixon's story to life, it became a multidimensional story. You started to see the dimensions of character within the students, within the teachers, within the adults who are important in their lives. You started to see how important this dimension of art really is to the students on an ongoing basis, and that it can be a role model for other schools to bring whatever they're passionate about into their classrooms in the ways that they can to help to encourage and engage their students on an ongoing basis. It also helped to build the respect. And I think you can see that just in this sample clip of Octavia working with her fellow students and helping to bring another student along so that he can become an honor roll student or do better in the grades in the class that he's in. The art collection that's throughout the school are by professional and very well-known artists. But there's also art that is in the school that is by the students themselves. And to teach entrepreneurship, one of the things that the school does, the first week in June, you might want to mark your calendar. Now that we've been in the pandemic, we haven't been able to go in person, but when it does open up, I hope you'll have a chance to visit the school. But the first week of June, they have really an art fair, and the art fair features the works of the students as artists. And in the art fair, you bid on their works of art. And it's a very, very aggressive bidding on beautiful works of art by the students. But it also teaches entrepreneurship. And the bidding starts somewhere around $25. The teachers, parents, the community are all part of it. Once again, I hope you hear. And going back to the Tree of Life, just making that connection. The Tree of Life, with one person after another being there to help build each other up. And that's part of community. That's part of respect for one another. And that's part of what the story was about, making it so much more than about an art collection that was founded by a principal and supported by the students and teachers throughout the school, but an art collection that really has meaning and substance to everyone that's involved there at Dixon Elementary School. In the art fair, you see entrepreneurship at work with the young artists putting up their artwork and with them doing their sales pitch and showing their beautiful works of art that they have created and that they have been inspired to create themselves. The next clip you're going to see is an example from that art fair and art entrepreneurship.
Usually around the first week in June, we have they have a silent auction, and she puts a bid ticket on every piece of artwork, and staff, parents, community are free to come in and bid on the student artwork. And at the end of the bidding period, the highest bidder gets to purchase the artwork from the student as artist and entrepreneur. And those dollars go directly to the student.
Hurry up and get it before it's over.
In the mist, it's dark. So I understand what you mean.
Don't let them take advantage of you. I'm like, they know you love all the art. I'm like, I do.
Because the original one is really dreamy and scary, but this one has, with the colors, it brings it to life. It's vibrant.
And if you don't bid,
I love it. And I love it right on this frame.
Oh, yeah, I like the color.
I framed all of them. I thought I'd never get finished with them.
Okay.
She had 147 pieces for the students this year. I just do it out of my house. I'm retired. I don't have a shop. It's so interesting because they have their imaginations is beyond what anybody could think of, because they can take colors and do so much with it. And if you look at the children's art, each time you look at it, you see something that you didn't see before.
One of the things that you see in this art fair is certain entrepreneurship, and you also see the eagerness of the students to sell their work and also to be seen and to know that the work that they're doing is important. When the community comes in to support the art fair, that again goes back to each other supporting one another in a very positive and affirmative way. It also goes back to that fourth R of respect. You also see within this documentary film, you see the people who are important and the relationships that have been built over time. Because this was a feature-length documentary, I filmed over a couple of years. It took me a while to get to know the teachers and the students. I didn't just walk in and point a camera. I initially walked in alone without a crew, really to get to know the people. By the time I brought a camera on board, I had gotten to know the teachers and they had become accustomed to seeing me. As a matter of fact, the students were so accustomed to seeing me there with the camera that they were sometimes forget that I was not part of the school. They would think I was a teacher. And in some ways that was very good because that meant they were so comfortable in being themselves that they were not necessarily acting for the camera. They could truly be themselves and really help the story come to life in the way that it was important for it to come to life. For you making a short documentary, you can bring your story to life by getting to know the people that you're going to focus on. And if it's the subject matter that you intend to expand upon, it's really doing your research in advance so that you are well-versed in that subject and know the questions that you will want to ask. Because I come out of a journalist background, I think the W's of storytelling are very important to me. And they should be for all of us when it comes to good storytelling. The who, the what, the why, the where, the when, all of that plays into making your story a story of substance and one that has great meaning to it. In the curators of Dixon School, the what is the art collection, the beautiful art collection. And it also served as a reminder for me not to dismiss a school's art collection. When I first learned that they had the art collection, I did think, oh, probably 8 or 10 nice pieces of works of art. I was not prepared for seeing the art collection that I saw, nor was I prepared for seeing and meeting the educators that I met and to see how devoted and committed they were to bringing their passion into their workplace, into the classroom, and into the students that they were working with. In meeting the students, they were so comfortable with the art collection. They knew it was something there of importance, but it was so much part of their everyday life, they didn't really see it as something to be featured. It was part of their everyday life and something that they enjoyed and took in stride, that it was part of their school. It was part of what made up their school and part of made up who they were at that stage of their life, a very important and formative stage. For racial healing, I think it's important for us to have that respect for one another and for ourselves. One of the reasons why I focus on the curators of Dixon School for this particular moment and in this presentation is because the racial healing comes through in respect. And respect is such an important part of the lesson in this art collection and in the school and in the people that I've met there. So the what is the art collection? That's an easy to see. The who are the key characters and people that I've introduced you to, from the educators to the students. The why? Why focus on the art collection? Well, for one thing, being a journalist and being a news reporter and having visited many Chicago public schools, I had never come across a public school like this before. I had never seen the amount of commitment that was given to its students, not only just the art collection itself. There were so many lessons that were taken that I took away in visiting the school and in seeing the art collection. There are so many lessons of resilience and respect and leadership that I took away in meeting each one of the students, from Octavia, who is mentoring, to Methuselah, who is a class president and the leader in the school, and to Gary, who admitted his vulnerability when it came to mathematics. The art fair is one example of showing entrepreneurship, but we also get a chance to see, well, how important it is to really tell the story, what that story is, and to translate it so that your audience goes on that journey with you. In telling this story, that's what you're charged to do as a filmmaker and storyteller. I have a clip here that shows just how important it is to tell the story before I wrap up. We're going to see a clip from Tell the Story.
Yes, I love. I love still life.
I gotta tell my
job. That's right.
I gotta tell my friend that Miss Crystal about.
That's right.
Long after we're gone, somebody needs to be here to tell the story of how all of this evolved and what it meant and what it will continue to mean for the children in our community.
So now, as young filmmakers, you are charged with telling the story. There are stories all around you. And when it comes to racial healing, this is a very important time in our history to tell these stories, to recognize these stories, to bring all of the learning R's into play. Racial healing, respect, resiliency. It's all part of what helps us learn to be better in our roles and part of a community and being there to help and to lift one another. It's the way that we can be there for each other and to really expand and evolve as a storyteller and as a filmmaker. As a filmmaker, we have the camera, we have the lens, but we also have our lens of experience, which guides us as well. And it helps us go to that next story. While I was at Dixon, as I said, the children became so comfortable with me and with the camera being there. They sometimes thought I was part of the school, which was good, but it also meant that they wanted to introduce me to the very important people in their lives. And many of those important people ended up being grandma, Nana, or Mother Dear. I met many grandparents, many grandmothers, and it was great to meet them. But as I was meeting them during the time of filming at the school, I was aware that I was meeting many grandparents, many grandmothers particularly. And I asked the social worker, you know, I seem to be meeting so many grandparents and grandmothers particularly. Is there a reason why? And I learned at that time that many of the students were being cared for on a full-time basis by their grandparents, by their grandmothers. I filed that story away to be that next seed for story, which became the G-Force. And the G-Force is a documentary film that I developed through Diverse Voices in Documentary, which is a joint effort of the Community Film Workshop and Cartemquin Films. With the G-Force, it focuses on grandparents raising grandchildren full time. So my time at Dixon led to that next seed for story, which became the G-Force. You are now charged with telling the story. I wish you luck in doing that, and I hope that I've been of help in some way to get you to that point. Thank you. Thanks, Heather.
Thanks so much, Pamela. So we're actually pretty close to 11 o'clock. And so I wanted to ask you, how many minutes do you want to do for questions? Just so I can make sure I'm respectful of your time.
Let's do the ones that we have here.
Okay, cool.
Okay.
Yes. So the first one that came up is, and this is kind of an amalgamation of several questions, but coming from a background as a print journalist, what drew you to telling stories through film? And what did it offer that you may have been missing when writing about something?
Well, for one thing, it offered me an opportunity to expand on the story. And that was something I really wanted to do. But even though I came from a print background as a journalist, I always saw myself as a storyteller first, because I've written stage plays, I've written long form journalism and done that reporting. So coming into documentary making and filmmaking seemed like a very organic way for me to continue my storytelling and to evolve as a storyteller. To be honest with you, there's some stories that seem to lend itself more to long form journalism or to reporting. There's some stories that seem to really speak to me in wanting to be a film and wanting to be a documentary. You can't see it here in my workplace, but I have post-it notes that speak to the various seeds of story, so to speak, of the next story that I'm going to develop and that I'm already starting to work on. And each one of those stories are already in my mind. I can see it as being a feature piece for a news organization or being a piece for a documentary. Each story seems to speak to how it wants to be told, and that's the way I go with it.
So you focused quite a bit on finding that seed for story, and you've given us some great examples, but for our participants who maybe don't have, you know, people sending you ideas about where to find stories, where do you recommend that they might go to find stories or individuals to interview to get their story started?
I would say you don't have to look very far. Even within your own family, there may be an object in an older relative's home that you've been curious about. You might want to ask that relative about it. It may be a story there in that object. One reason why I bring that up as an example, some years ago, I was sitting across from a woman at a beauty salon, and I noticed that she was always very quiet. And often at beauty salons, people are very talkative. And she had a bracelet that she would sometimes twist on her arm. The next time I saw her, I asked her about that bracelet. And from that story, I learned of her journey from Alabama. I learned of how she came to Chicago. I learned of the young age she came to Chicago and her willingness to leave her sisters and brothers and to start anew. So again, I say really be curious, use that curiosity, and you don't have to wait for someone to bring you the story idea. There are stories around you. Just think about some of the people who are in your life, talk to them, interview them, and be curious about the people who you see, be curious about the people who are in your life, and ask questions. That's where the journalist in you can come out. Ask questions, be that reporter. You'll be surprised what happens when you go past hello and how are you and get to that real question.
So one of our participants, and it's great that you brought up hearing stories from your families, because one of our participants mentions that she's never made a film, but she's watched hundreds of documentaries. And so she's really interested in creating a film about her family and ancestors. And she's done tons of research and has photos, but as she's doing the work, the project just keeps getting bigger and bigger. And so she's not really sure where to start. And she wondered if you had any advice.
Oh, we have all been there as filmmakers in terms of that story getting bigger and bigger and bigger. And you have so much footage and so much information. But that is a wonderful place to be. Take it from me, it really is. But the most important thing for you to do is to stay focused. What is the story that you want to tell? For me, I was focused on the Tree of Life because there were so many stories within that school that I could have focused on. But I used the Tree of Life as my focal point. So that was what I stayed focused on and what that message meant and how was I going to bring that out throughout the story. So my advice to someone who has many images and is already doing the research is, what brought you to the story? Why did you want to do the story? Ask yourself that question. That is often the seed for the story. For me, the reason why I wanted to do the Dixon story and to focus on that art collection was not just because it was a beautiful collection, but I had seen so many stories about Chicago public schools, so many stories about African-American young people that were negative, that it drove me to tell a story that was going to bring out a multidimensional look at the African-American youth and educators in a light that really shined a light on the community and the people, so that it wasn't just a flat one-dimensional story. That was what drove me and motivated me to stay with the story and to focus in the way that I did.
So you touched on this a little bit in your answer to the last question. So I do want to follow up with this. Mm-hmm. Why is it important to you to tell stories specifically about African Americans beyond what you've already shared?
One of the reasons it's important is because we don't hear our stories. And as an African-American woman, as an African-American storyteller, I know we have so many stories to tell. I mean, just within my family alone, there are stories for me to tell. And even though I don't have those stories on the screen, those stories serve as background for me. They serve as a foundation for me in terms of the stories that I do ultimately tell, whether I'm telling it for a journalist organization or whether I'm making it into a film. It's important to tell that story because we're an overlooked community. Our story has not been told, and we don't even know the stories there. Even in doing the story on Dixon, the curators of Dixon School, when the movie made its debut, there were people who lived down the street from the school who admitted they had no idea that the art collection was there. They had no idea what the school was doing. Some of them were very tearful about it, not realizing that they were passing the school on an ongoing basis and that it was right there in their neighborhood. They knew it was a good school, but they had no idea what was really going into the making of those young people that were coming out of the school.
You know, I grew up with an older grandmother, and so many of my life experiences come from her stories, right? And just the connections that you make to that. So I think that's such an important point, is that we all need to hear our stories and to, you know, see them in our lives and around us. So those were kind of the more philosophical questions. So we have a couple technical questions now before we wrap up. So aside from building a relationship with your subjects, what would you say is the most important piece in building a documentary?
I'm going to go back to focus. I think it's very important for you to have a focus. And when I say focus, and I ask myself this question, and if I would move my laptop around my apartment, you would see where I have little signs up to myself. And I ask myself the question, why am I doing this? Why is it important for me to do? So that brings me back to that focal point. What is it about this story that's keeping me here? Because filmmaking is hard. It is not an easy thing to do. And sometimes, as one of the people who asked a question about what do I do, and I'm making a documentary for the first time, and I have all this information, you get so much information, but you have to stay focused and remember what brought me into this story and what do I want, what kind of journey do I want to take people on who are going to view the story? Not dictating them how to think, but what kind of journey do I want to take them on?
Perfect. So this question, actually the person who asked this question, Cheryl, said this might seem like a very basic question, but she wants to know how necessary is writing in the way you craft your films?
My editor, who I work with, a wonderful editor, Sharon Zurich of Black Cat Productions, in the years that we have worked together on shorts, feature-length documentaries, and even narrative films, she would tell you, I tend to write out quite a bit. And that comes from my writer background. So in some ways, I almost edit on the page in terms of how I see the story unfolding. And I, because I do come from a writerly background, even as I'm filming, I make notes to myself about different images, about different shots that I know are going to be important and why. And maybe I will come back to those shots and use them, and maybe I won't. But they're there as a reminder to me about that story. And I start to see a thread. I start to see a thread going throughout. And maybe that's how I begin to build the story. So the writing background is very important to me.
Perfect. So this question is kind of an amalgamation of several questions. So for participants, if I didn't 100% get it, I apologize. Feel free to follow up. For our participants who have never made a film and may never have entered a contest with a film before, what do you think is the best way for them to get started with probably a low budget while still presenting a good quality film?
I think one of the ways to get started is to break through the breakthrough fear, not to be afraid. And given the fact that we do have smartphones that can capture images, that's a way for you to also capture an interview with someone. You may not use the interview, but it can be there to help build up your confidence in terms of the story that you want to tell. I can give an example. Certainly when I first went out on my scouting and looking to see what kind of story I was going to build from curators, I did not have the professional camera with me. I had my smartphone with me. And I wasn't expecting to capture something good. But during my initial meeting with people, sometimes there were things that were very good that I didn't want to lose for myself. And later I ended up using and incorporating it into the film. So I would say for you to not be afraid. If you have a smartphone, and I think most people do nowadays, use that as your kind of your first draft, your first cut, so to speak, and see what you have and see where you're going with it.
So I think this follows up kind of nicely with your last comments about fear and kind of getting past the fear. So you obviously have talked about starting from a journalistic background. Mm-hmm. How did you know you could be a filmmaker? How did you make that leap?
I didn't feel like it was much of a leap for me because being a news reporter, I often called people cold. I often walked up to people who had no idea who I was, who frequently did not want to speak to me because I was a reporter. So I think I had already broken through the fear, and maybe I didn't understand the fear of being a filmmaker because of that. But for me, I did see some stories very cinematically. You know, for example, this story that I shared in the presentation on the art collection, it was not going to come to life in the same way as a written piece. It was going to be much fuller and have a lot more dimension to it as a film, as it did here. So it was really, I think, just breaking through that fear, knowing that you can do it, trusting your gut and your instincts, and going with it. I know it sounds simple, and I still have to work through that on an ongoing basis too. But somehow I pick up the phone, I make that call. I do more than email. I do find, you know, building relationships is both ways, particularly nowadays. You know, you make the initial contact, perhaps with an email. I follow up with a phone call for a voice-to-voice introduction. And then I set up a time when we can meet in person. There's nothing like that face-to-face contact. There's nothing like reading that face and really feeling a connection to that person. I mean, that's important for you as a filmmaker, as well as for the person who you're going to make the film about.
Perfect.
I hope that helped.
No, I think it's great. So again, more technical question. Do you have any favorite editing tools that you would recommend for our participants to use?
You know, I'm not the one who does the editing. I do have a fantastic editor, Sharon Zirk, who does that. And I know there's some people who will do all, they wear all of the hats. And I've worn all the hats in terms of writer, director, producer, and I've even worked camera. However, I have found I can become too married to my material. And that means that there are some things that I don't want to let go. And my editor, Sharon, can speak to that when we have these fights over, no, that has to stay in. No, that has to stay in at that length. And finally, I have to let it go and understand, you know, it really does work better shorter. It really does work better without this particular scene. So with editing tools, I can't really recommend one, but I will recommend, if possible, have someone else be your other set of eyes to look at your work.
So I think that actually aligns kind of nicely with the next question, which is, you know, obviously if you're editing and you're really married to something and you don't want to lose it, you're kind of stuck in the story, right? So yeah. Do you have any tips for participants who maybe get stuck at any different point in the story, in the conceptualization and the writing and the filming? You know, just what tips do you have for those participants who are, you know, they're interested, they're engaged, but they're stuck?
You've got to step away from it. I mean, because we can all become so engrossed in our work, and particularly when it's a subject matter that is important to you. And for me, the documentary films that I do and the subject matters are very important. The G-Force documentary that I mentioned about grandparents raising grandchildren. I did not have a grandmother or grandparents raising me. My parents were very much present and very involved in my life. However, I had the elders in my family. Their hands were all over me. My great aunts, my great uncles, they were all there. I grew up during a time when we lived in the same neighborhood, sometimes in the same building together. And their influence was very prevalent in my life. And it was something that I'm very fortunate and very grateful to have had. With grandmothers and grandparents, it's important to know that that story is particularly one in the African-American community of caring for another child, of caring for someone else's children, and knowing that it goes back to a village, but it's also seeing all the children as your children, that you're there to take care of them. So in terms of being stuck, you kind of see that story as it evolves, and that you don't really have to stay in one place. You know what stories matter to you most. And for me, it's those type of social stories that matter to me most. So I don't stay stuck in a place very, very long, you know, which is why it's so helpful to have that extra pair of eyes. It helps you get unstuck, because otherwise you can replay a scene over and over again and convince yourself it has to stay, it has to stay. And when you get that extra set of eyes, it's like, yes, that's good, but let's move on.
Right. So I'm not really sure, there's kind of a question I'm not really sure how I want to approach. So you definitely have seemed to focus on documentaries and both in journalism as well, you know, kind of documenting the world as you see it around you, or really the participants' lived experience. But have you ever created a fictionalized account to represent something that you know is happening in the world around you? And if you do that, how have you gone about it?
As a matter of fact, I received and won an American Best Screenwriting Award from Oliver Stone some decades ago. And that screenplay was called Natchez. It was not made, it hasn't been made into a film yet, but it did win critical acclaim. And Natchez is named for the Natchez, Mississippi, but it takes place here in Chicago. And it is based on a real story that took place, but the story is fictionalized. So I have had that experience. And also in the stage plays that I've written, I have had that same experience as well in using a nonfiction topic and expanding it so that it is told in a fictional way.
So if one of our participants wants to do that, do you have any tips for them so that they can make that fictionalized story really reflect reality?
One of the ways that you do that is that you first start with, the nugget of the truth. So for Natchez, for example, there's a horrible fire that had taken place. And as a girl, I had heard about this fire that had taken place in Natchez. It was at a nightclub where everyone was looking forward to this entertainer coming from Chicago to perform and sing. But unfortunately, due to the racism in that community at the time, they had boarded up the place where they were going to have the performance. And once everyone had arrived inside, someone had set the place on fire. And when I said they had boarded it up, they had made it so that people could not escape through the windows. And people unfortunately died in the fire. Now, this was a story that I had heard through old relatives and old people talking about it for many years. And I did my research as a reporter to find out more about it. But then I expanded that story into a screenplay that won the award.
Wow, that's awesome. So I wanted to end with a fun question, I think. This is actually one of the first questions that was asked, but I think I wanted to end with it. That's fun. So you spent all this time at Dixon Elementary and you got to look at all these amazing pieces of art. So what was your favorite piece that you saw while you were at Dixon?
Oh, wow, I wish I could walk you through my apartment. My goodness, I have pieces of art everywhere. But I'm going to move over just a little bit and show you one piece that's right behind me. Let's see. So if you can see it, it looks like it's a hand there, and the hand has a heart in it, several hearts, and it is planting seeds. And it happens to fit with this, Seeds for Story. So I love this piece of art from the Dixon School. And I purchased it during the time that I was filming there. And what I loved about it is because the Seeds for Story are there not only in what we're talking about as far as making films, but it represents what the school is about. It was the seeds that they were planting in making the young people be who they could be best in their lives. So that's one of my favorite pieces. And it really serves as inspiration to me as I work.
It's so funny that that's the piece. When you were showing the film clip, I saw that one. I was like, oh, that one looks really cool. So there you go. We apparently have similar tastes in art. Well, Pamela, thank you so much for sharing both the amazing clips and your filmic experience and your advice with our participants. It's been such a great session and so wonderful to get to just hear this wealth of experience that you've been able to share. So thank you so much for that.
Thank you, Heather. And good luck to everyone. I can't wait to hear and see about your films. I know you're going to do well, and your stories are important. They matter.
That's great. So before we leave, I'd also like to take a minute to thank our sponsor, Healing Illinois, a racial healing initiative of the Illinois Department of Human Services and the Chicago Community Trust. Thank you too for our participants and those of you who joined us on your Saturday morning. Before you go, I would like to remind you that we have one remaining expert session next Saturday, March 6th at 10 a.m. Central Standard Time. Next week, we'll hear from Tishon Taylor as she shares her session, Trust Your Gut, The Stories You Were Born to Tell. To register for Sean's session, visit the contest website at bit.ly/no malice, which I've pasted into the chat box. If you missed any of our prior three sessions, or you hopped in today's session a bit late, or let's be honest, if Zoom kicked you out for a minute or two and you missed something, we're posting recordings of all the sessions on that page so you can catch up or rewatch them if you need help while you're working on your films. Before I end the webinar, please do me a favor and shoot me a quick chat telling me where you're watching from and how many people are watching with you. But we are going to go ahead and go back to the blank screen of just sharing the logo so you have a chance to get those chat messages in. So thank you again for spending your Saturday morning with us, and we hope to see you again next weekend.